Professor Rohan Lucas, or more dearly known as Lucas Sir, is a happy sight to anyone who's lucky enough to bump into him at a corridor of the Department of Electrical Engineering at the University of Moratuwa. He has a smile on his face and his tongue in his cheek, and more often than not, a solution to most of our petty issues. During my stay at the department as his student, the two most striking features of his lectures were his impressive ability to do the most complicated of calculations in thin air, like a wizard conjuring a magic trick, and his knack for the simplest of analogies to make us understand an intricate theory. I take this opportunity to invite this great intellectual to not embark upon complicated theories of electrical engineering, but to share with us a secret or two of his life and times. So please oblige.
Dear honored guests, ladies and gentlemen, I think from what Professor William Endis mentioned, from what the compere mentioned, I'm not very good at speaking. That is why even at Toastmasters, I did not go beyond the icebreaker. I may be good at speaking on technical topics, but I'm very bad at public speaking. So you'll have to excuse me, I will make you some notes. Even at the icebreaker, the mistake they found was I was using notes. They said, you cannot use notes in Toastmasters. Why did I decide to write an autobiography? About 2 years back, I thought I must write my life story to my friends. So I wrote my life story and sent it to a few friends, one of whom wrote back and told me, why don't I write an expanded version, because my students will like to read that. Then I wrote an expanded version and sent to many, including to my friend Yuri Javadana, and many of them wrote back with tributes, which I never expected. The tributes that I normally see of that type are when people are dead. So I thought, I don't want to be dead for people to write about me. I would like to see what they would like to write about me. And therefore I decided my autobiography will have two parts. First part is what I will write about myself. And the second part is what others think of me. So this autobiography is actually the outcome of that. As Professor William Endis mentioned, and maybe even others, I don't do things the way others do. I have talked about how I came into the world using statistics, and I've talked about entering the third planet from the sun, which is the Earth. And of course, I've given some statistics, none of which may be relevant. But it goes on to show why I was born at a particular time. It was to bring independence to Sri Lanka. Perhaps we got independence within 4 months of my birth, because I would have refused to live in a country under occupation. And I would have given an ultimatum to my next door neighbor, JR, who would have done the needful on my behalf. So that's the way I like to look at it. Where was I during my young days? Where presently the LTL city office is. That doesn't belong to me, it belongs to my brothers and so on. I lived there for over 20 years, and I studied at St. Joseph's. I made use of the family tree to connect the people in that, but I'm not going into that. It's just to show that this is also included in my biography. I'll be going through my slides fairly fast, because the idea of this is for you to know what sort of things are there in the biography, so that you will buy the biography and read it. When I was young, I used to play with various toys. Some of them were, I had something where you had actual bricks, very small size, with paste. When the paste ran over, I used to make paper and paste the bricks with that. Because if you want to get the bricks back, it should be something that is soluble. Then we had mechanisms. Of course, these pictures are not my pictures, I took it from the web. But these are the type of equipment that I had when I was small. Electrical construction kit. I even had a weaving kit, something very similar to the picture that is shown, and I learned to do weaving. And in fact, when I was small, I used to even sew the covers for the sofas, rounded sofas, and I got a very good fit for those. Even I did rattan weaving for the seats. The first experiment I did in school was to make copper sulfate crystals. That canister is still there with me, with the date written there. I don't think it can be seen there, but I take pride in that. Then my sister also had what is called a chemical garden, where you have soluble water glass, and you add chemicals to it, and it grows. So all these made me interested in engineering. My first calling was obviously at St. Bridget's Convent. I was there for I don't know how many years. There was a letter given to promote me to the upper kindergarten. Unfortunately, the letter of referral had got lost, and I was put to the lower kindergarten when I entered St. Joseph's College. I lost 1 year, but I thought, I can't lose 1 year, so I fought for it. And when I came to the advanced level, from the advanced level, I didn't go to the first year of engineering. I went to the second year. So that the lost year, I gained. And I proudly say that I entered engineering when I was 19, and I completed it when I was 21. So many people would want to know what it is, so that you can read the book. We have what is called the slide rule. Most people nowadays wouldn't even know what it is. It is something based on logarithms. So when you use that, logarithms make you add things when you want to multiply. So the slide rule works on that principle. All our coursework and so on was done there. During our, I think, third year, we had vacation training. I went to Steel Corporation and we were given a project. Our project was, now we would call it an energy audit, and I believe Tilak or someone else said perhaps it's one of the first energy audits done in Sri Lanka. Our life at Peradeniya was very joyful. We had a very large area in front of the faculty, and it was decided to have a paddy field. That paddy field, if you look carefully, you can see stretches over a very large number of buildings. There were no nearers in that because it was surveyed and leveled to such an extent you could have one, and you can see them planting and later reaping. Unfortunately, this is a picture I got from a friend, so I don't know whether I'm there in the picture or not, but I was part of that. We graduated in 69. At that time, there were no convocations because I think there were certain problems before that. But myself and a friend of mine got together and organized a graduation where we got all our batchmates to come to Peradeniya. And after that, we also gave a sumptuous lunch to all the staff. And also we gave a free photograph to all those who came. And I think we charged them rupees 25 for all that. Since that time, we have been meeting at a quite regular basis, at least once in 5 years, a major one, and every few months, minor ones. Two of them are 30th anniversary, and a couple of months ago, we had the 45th anniversary at Peradeniya, where we went and donated a seminar room, modern, fully equipped seminar room, And one of the architects of the seminar room is Vernon Severinus, who is seated there. Most of my life, obviously, was at Cuddebeth. So this is a picture taken a long time ago. And no, I can't get the mouse moving. Number one in the middle is the Sumanadas building, where the electrical engineering department is located. After joining Cuddebeth, I was very fortunate. Very fortunate in the sense that the UNESCO came searching after me to my home and virtually begged me to fill the forms and accept a fellowship. With that fellowship, I went abroad and did a PhD. Most others would have the exact opposite. So I am very lucky because I think a certain number of fellowships were allocated to Moro Tour, and I was very fortunate to get that. If you look carefully there, you can see we had 20 participants for our master's course. Those came from 15 different countries. So as Professor Willy Mendes mentioned, Cambodian was one of them. All the others, other than two people, were not from England. Only two were from England. Our wedding. Again, we were very fortunate. My next door neighbor came and signed. He had just become the first executive president a few months before our wedding. We were also fortunate that the Chief Justice and the Archbishop were also there at our wedding. I like to do creative things. Our first Christmas, we bought a set of the statues, and I needed a crib to have this thing. When I was young, I used to use a paper pulp and try to make things. Then I found it rots. So this time I used wood dust, pulp and copper sulfate to make sure that it doesn't rot, and made this. This has lasted from 1978 till now, with few patches here and there. This has been taken very recently. When my daughter was young, I made a doll's house for her. That is made out of plywood. And the full front can be taken out. There's even electricity supply inside with a table lamp. Then I also like to deal with sewing. Of course, the basic sewing would have been done by my wife, Ramala. But the cap, the beak, and the wings were designed and made by me. Obviously, I can't have a life without my wife and daughter. So my daughter also entered Moro Tour. And these are some of her highlights, ending up with the wedding, where Professor Malik Ransinger was one of the chief guests. And Father Sriandra Ransinger, I think, is also in the picture. I like to be versatile. So one of the things is, I like to climb even at this age. I won't go through all this, but I will just talk about climbing down Sripada rather than climbing Sripada. I can see some smiling faces at the back. At the age of 65, just before the new year, we climbed Sripada. Peak of season, not a single person climbing. Right. We climbed up, saw the sunrise, and when we were coming down, I went on strike at something like Indigatapana. My legs were not moving, and one of my neighbors is just behind. He and another neighbor were the only two people with me. And they almost got a heart attack and gave frantic calls. Fortunately, we rested for a few minutes at one of the umbrellas. After that, magically, I had more energy to come down than even then. Next one is when we climbed the Great Wall of China. This is on a visit for the review of the lotus flower. This particular period, because there was ice, even the Chinese were not climbing it. And I was told, no, you can't climb it. I didn't give up. Four of us started climbing. The two youngest people and me managed to climb to the top, and then we came back. This is not in the book, but I thought I will add because I found it a little later. I think you can recognize whom I'm playing with. Arthur Clarke, well-known science fiction writer. We inaugurated a table, tennis table, for the university. Then, as Professor Willimendis mentioned, or no, I think Professor Rihan has mentioned, some of the pictures. One of the advantages we have is every 7 years or so, we get a chance to update our knowledge. When you update your knowledge, quite often you go abroad. And when you go abroad, in addition to updating your knowledge, you get to see various things. So here again, my daughter was like in 2 years, for her second birthday, I made a cardboard mold for a teddy bear and made that cake. The basic cake was made by my wife, but the decorations and the shaping was done by me. Sabbatical in Manitoba, sabbatical in New Zealand. This one is a 90-mile beach. Actually, it's not 90 miles, it's about 90 kilometers long. On this stretch, you can drive at the speed where you can drive on any highway. Highway rules obey on this road. That is beach, and that beach is washed twice a day. Around the year 2001, or maybe 2000, we went for this semester system. And as Professor Willimendis mentioned, there are a lot of debates. I tried to present these debates using the personal in electrical engineering and maybe even others, or SI units. So Ampere says current topics must be introduced in the new curriculum. Ohm says let's resist the whole idea of change. Haven't we done well enough without it during our day? So I made use of the personalities in the units and use words which correspond to those to bring out what we were doing. Again, as an engineer, you can't just do things the normal way. You have to sometimes think out of the box. With Mr. Yuri Javadana, soon after, I think, my presidential talk for the IEE, we decided if there can be transformers made with sunflower oil, why not coconut oil? So we did some research, and we actually made a transformer and put it into service somewhere in Piliandra. And it ran for more than 2 years. After that, of course, I lost touch. Still there? Right. When we tried to get it tested, the oil tested in UK, they refused saying, oil freezes. You can't use it. But then they didn't realize that in our country, if you go to Norelia, maybe it will freeze. But it may not, because if an energized transformer is hotter than that. Then there are some other things also that I have done. If you light a fire or candle and hide it under a bush, the candle is useless. It must give light to the world. So in the same way, whatever I do, now these are some other books that I have produced for the Open University, and this is Google Scholar records and a conference I attended. So dissemination of knowledge is something that is very important. My creations. Now, most engineers think from, I think, the left brain. They do not use their right brain, which is artistic. There are a lot of things that can be done if you use your right brain. So recently, I started writing some poetry as well as some creations. I'll just read parts of it on forgiveness, because forgiveness and thanking are things that are essential if you want to be a human being. The new year has dawned The old year is forever gone. May any pains of sorrow fade away. Let the memories of joy live on. Drive away fears and doubts that make strangers out of friends. Forgive friends who angered you, but try to make amends. Similarly, recently we had to make some presentation for an award, QIG award, and one of our colleagues spent a lot of time sacrificing his own time to do that. I feel it's not fair if you don't thank him properly. And thanking using a poem is much more effective just saying thanks. So I created this, just a little verse to express our heartfelt gratitude for your true dedication and your positive attitude. We could never have found a more dedicated volunteer. It has been a privilege to work with one so sincere. Okay. I'm one, when I was in school, was not good in poetry. In fact, I used to virtually skip or try to skip a class if I had to recite a poem. Now these are, fortunately, there's something called the internet. On the internet, you can find rhyming words and various helps that you can get. So if your ideas are there, you can make things like this. My creations. When we were young, students used to make cartoons out of us. What sort of cartoons? Once I can remember, I am frightened of heights. So you have this Dangmal Palama, and we had to cross a fairly long one on a Dangmal Palama, and I was probably shaking. Next day on the notice board, there was this Dangmal Palama, probably drawn by Vajir Jekun. Because he says that he remembers doing something like that. Anyway, nowadays students don't do that. I hear sometimes they may be putting it on Facebook, but I don't see Facebook. So I thought I will create cartoons. This shows a path to graduation with pitfalls, and I am shown near the ravine holding a torch and saying, you don't have to cross across the ravine, you can take the path by the side and things like that. And at the end, you can also see there's lightning striking the cup that is holding, and there's a lightning conductor on top. Then there are other things that I've created. When students perform well, sometimes I use a clapping smiley. People who are marginal, a wandering smiley. And people who are about to fail, I give them another chance by putting things like that. Then some other awards that I won. Okay. Now I've retired. Fortunately, I'm still able to go to the university. So I hope this is not going to happen to me. The first one shows what most people used to say about me in the past. I hope the second one is not what is going to happen to me in the future. I believe that if you want people to laugh, you must be able to laugh at yourself as well. Don't laugh at others, laugh with them. And of course, I feel that I must leave something. I've got donations from the electricity board, these circuit breaker panels, vacuum circuit breaker panels, transformers, and so on from Lanka Transformers, components for transmission lines from LECO, half a kilometer of high power cables from one of the cable manufacturers. Then recently we got a donation of a generator. So all these, fortunately, my students willingly give me. So millions of rupees worth, we are building a simulator. Then of course, as an engineer, if you are only going to do academic work and research, that's not satisfactory. One of the things that I like is that you must get involved in engineering. So these are some other things that I've got involved in. I want to talk about the people I want to thank. First of all, of course, I wish to thank my God, who has always been by my side. My teachers, mentors, my superiors, advisors, my friends in industry, in the staff, and in the classroom. Last, but not most importantly, my family and friends who have been with me throughout my life. Now, I've selected the 16 people here, not randomly, but with a meaning. I've not selected everyone at the top level. I've taken a full cross-section of people I meet. It would be wrong if I do not honor those who taught me from my school days to that at the university. In particular, I would like to name Professor Sam Karunaratna, who not only taught me at the university at Peradeniya, but was my mentor at the University of Morotua for 33 years. Dr. Key Cornick, that's the person who, with whom I did my PhD, who guided me in my doctoral research at UMIS, and my colleagues, Professor Peter McLaren and Professor Jossal Ariraga, who subsequently fostered my research abilities. So when I went on my sabbatical leaves, I always went to a university so that I can develop myself. And these were the people who helped me to develop myself and achieve what I am today. Thus, I wish to give the first of my autobiographies to Professor Sam Karunaratna, without whom I would not be where I am today. So I will read everything before I give, and then after that I will give the books. I have been blessed with esteemed superiors in the form of chancellors, vice chancellors, and deans of the university. I have known our present chancellor, Professor KKYW Pereira, from the day I joined Morotua as the then professor of electronics and telecommunications to the present, where he is now our beloved chancellor. I wish to present the next copy to him. Vice chancellors with whom I work closely are too numerous to mention by name. I selected Professor Willie Mendes, whom I have known closely for a long time, and who wrote my foreword as one of the recipients, while the present Vice Chancellor, Professor Anand Javadana, as the next recipient to represent the university administration. I believe it is necessary for engineers to help develop our beloved country with their technical expertise. I know for sure engineer D.J. Wimalasurendra saw what he termed, he wanted to light 100,000 lamps, Laksa Pahana, which now become Laksa Pahana. Now, when he saw that and he said that, he was not able to get that done. So he went to Parliament and saw it through. Thus, I have selected my former student, Honorable Patali Champika Ranavata, to be the next recipient, because I believe that we don't have enough people in Parliament to represent us. There are plenty of lawyers, but then lawyers alone can't develop a country. Engineering is not just maintaining existing structures. My student, engineer Yudi Javadana, led from the front and developed Lamka transformers from a mere distribution transformer factory to the international giant that LTL Holdings has become. Thus, the next copy goes to him. From the days of my graduation as an electrical engineer, I believe that engineers have to primarily serve society, even if they are in the academia. Thus, I have always been involved in professional institutions in honorary capacities. Thus, I wish to honor them by presenting my next book to engineer Xavi Fernando. He is not only the president of IESL, but also the general manager of the Ceylon Electricity Board. I have led a very happy life teaching at the University of Morotua because of the friends I made there. Among these are the staff of the university, especially in the department. I will thus present my autobiography to the current head of department, Professor P. Nath Dias, being one of those whom I have known since I was an instructor at Peradeniya, and I believe I instructed him at that time. So he was probably one of my first students, although that I did not teach him. And Professor Nalin Vikramachi, representing my colleagues in the university. I consider not only the academia as my friends, but also all other levels in the university. Thus, I will honor my non-academic friends by giving my autobiography to the technical officer of my laboratory, Mr. Ashoka Chandra, and to Ms. Suani Fernando, who gives us secretarial assistance in coordinating our 3 master's courses. So she is not even on the permanent staff, but still, we get a lot of help from them, and we need to recognize them. I owe a lot to my classmates and my students, who by their gratitude expressed in my autobiography has made my teaching them to be fully worthwhile. I selected to honor my close friend, Jayathikala hallmate, I was in Jayathikala hall throughout my stay, and 1969 batchmate, engineer Vernon Severinus Veerasinghe as my next recipient. I selected to honor my friend, specialist in protection, engineer Jayasri Karunanayaka from the very first batch at Morotua that I taught. So I've actually covered students from the first batch, Jayasri Karunanayaka, and my friend Guanti Abesinghe in perhaps the most junior batch that I have taught at Morotua, currently in the third year of studies to represent my beloved students. Last but not the least, I wish to thank my family and friends who have put up with my eccentricity to allow me to teach my students. Obviously, it's not easy to get on with me. I wish to thank my beloved parents who brought me up, my siblings with whom I grew up, my relatives and close friends. In particular, I wish to express my gratitude to my beloved wife Ramala, my daughter Roshanti, and my son-in-law Lakshit Gunaratna, for being always by my side. To represent friends of the family and my spiritual life, I wish to honor Reverend Father Sriyan Ranasinghe, who has been my close friend. And to represent my family, I wish to give my final first copy to Roshanti Lucas Gunaratna. I'm not going to read the names, so I'm very thankful to all my honored guests, to the sponsors, to all of you well-wishers, and of course, the event coordinators.
Thank you, Professor Lucas. That was quite an amusing talk. And now I believe it is time to present the first copies of the autobiography to the honored guests.